Greetings to all of you that are watching me on this wonderful and exciting program, Monday Business Mentorship. It's a new program that we have that seeks to empower you and to align you with exactly what it is that God wants you to accomplish. The reason why I'm bringing in God, it is because you are His product. And the purpose of the product lies with the manufacturer of the product. So I believe that mentorship is the quickest way to success. And that's the reason why I've decided to make myself available so that you can be empowered and you can be equipped, so that you can reach your highest level of success as soon as possible. Now, when this program was advertised, you were asked to send questions that are of concern to you, where you need mentorship, areas where you feel you need guidance, areas where you have realized that you need more light. And to begin with, of the many questions that you have sent, I have seen this one predominant question rising above the many questions that you sent. And it was on vision. And that's the best way I can summarize that, because it was mostly, I would want to know exactly what is my vision. What can I do with my vision? How do I run with my vision? How do I support my vision? And on this program, Monday Business Mentorship, most of you have also made making money your vision. So I think if we are to start from there, it's going to be a good thing. So I want you to bear with me. Let's start from that point. What is a vision? Do you have a vision? And do you understand the vision that you have? And how can you bring your vision to fruition? So, I'm going to make reference to one of the most important books on the earth that the Creator has made available, which I believe is the manual through which anything on the earth can be operated properly. There is a declaration by one of the most intelligent persons that ever lived, who had wisdom that he got from the Almighty. And this was the king of Israel by the name Solomon. God gave him an ability to look at things, dissect them, analyze them, and understand them. And he wrote in one of his books, Proverbs 29, verse number 18, where there is no vision, the people perish. Where there is no vision, the people perish. But that's not the main scripture that I would want to deal with. We'll go to Habakkuk chapter number 2 and verse number 2. But starting with that, the letter by the man of wisdom, Solomon, he says, where there is no vision, the people perish. Whether it's a company that you're running, it's a business that you have, it's an idea that you carry, that's a vision. So what is a vision? I believe that a vision is a part of your brain where your future is contained. There is a place in your faculties, there is a place in your understanding, there is a place in your reasoning where your future can be discovered. Who you shall become, what you are in the future, can be found in a certain place right in your mind. A vision can be a mental picture. A vision can be a portrait. A vision can be an image. A vision can be a dream. A vision can be an idea. A vision can be a thought. A vision can be a light. The little light that shines in darkness. Now, when Solomon, the man of wisdom, who of course you know he wasn't a Christian, there were no Christians back then, but he was a man of wisdom and understanding. He's telling us that without a vision, what happens is that the people perish. So let's start from there. I believe that's the reason why you really wanted to understand what your vision is and how to go around your vision in bringing your vision to pass. Now, on that passage of scripture, you have to understand there are very, very important aspects that you find there. Where there is no vision, the people perish. He has mentioned the first thing there is the location, the place where there is no vision. So he's helping you to understand that vision is not available in every place. There is a place which is void of visions. Place in existence, somewhere, maybe where you are. And within that place, there is no vision. And what happens to the people in such a place? They perish. So what is killing people is the absence of a vision. What has destroyed communities is the absence of a vision. What has brought down very big corporations is lack of vision. So he has told us of a possibility of having a place and having people within that place, and yet there is no presence of a vision, which is now dangerous. That is one of the most dangerous places that you can be, being in a place where there is no vision, because what happens to you is you die. So what has killed most of our people today is lack of vision. So I'm trying to help you understand right now at this point that you can be in a place where there is no vision. And what is happening is not just you perishing, but everything about you and everything around you is dying because of the absence of a vision. Number two, he's telling us that there are people in the place where there is no vision. Where there is no vision, the people perish. So already you can see, in the place where there is no vision, something else is there And what is the people? What has made the people to want to stay in such a place? What has made you to stay in an organization which doesn't have a vision? What has made you to stay in a company which is visionless? I want you to understand, think about that, because it is possible that you can be in a place. The place is still a place. You can be in a company. The company is still a company. You can belong to a ministry, and the ministry is still a ministry. Yet the place doesn't have a vision. All it has are the people. So what has made the people to stay in a place that doesn't have a vision? Why? Because they have lacked an individual vision, a personal vision. You must have a personal vision that helps you to discern the vision of the place. You must have a personal vision that helps you to diagnose the place and find out and discover the bigger vision of the place. So lacking that personal vision will lead you into staying in a place where there is no bigger vision, the vision of the place. And there you perish. So at this point, you must have an eye that can see into the organization and realize the absence of the vision of the organization. So it's not all about the place not having a vision, but also the people within that place must have a vision. The vision that helps them to see the absence of the vision of the place. So that immediately you have to evacuate, you have to depart from such a place, otherwise you perish. Where there is no vision, the people perish. So I want you to realize this mighty revelation. What are you doing in a place where there is no vision? Don't remain there simply because of structures. Don't remain there simply because a place is a place. Not every place is suitable for you. So understand, where you have no presence of a vision, quickly you have to depart. So I'm helping you understand, because some of you, you are in such places where all you have in that place is yourself and no vision. Now, help me to understand my vision. I want to understand my vision. In Habakkuk chapter number 2 and verse number 2, the Lord, who is our God, gave an instruction, not just to the prophet. I'm not going to try to make this religious, but I want you to understand that this man that you thought was just a prophet is also a visionary. And when God had given Habakkuk the visionary, the vision, he demanded that he acts upon that vision in a certain way, which are going to be the guidelines. I'm giving you the framework on how you can properly articulate your vision. And he was told by the giver of the visions, because you want to know what is your vision. Now, before we get into that, you have to realize one thing, which is very, very critical, that You can't have a visionary without the vision. Yet you can have the vision without the visionary. A visionary is made a visionary by the vision. But you can have a vision without the visionary. Just like you can have a bus without the driver. You can have a plane without the pilot. The plane still remains a plane, even without anyone flying it. You have to understand that. So you can't have a visionary without a vision. But you can have a vision without the visionary, because visions are created by a superior being. And visions are stored in a place waiting for the visionary to perceive them. So it is you having a vision that qualifies you to become a visionary. You have to understand that first part. You are as important as your business. The way you treat yourself is very, very critical. Are you a visionary? And what has made you a visionary if it is not the vision? If you don't have a vision, then you are not a visionary. So, I'm trying to touch as many areas as I can, so that I can help most, because your questions, most of them, were along those lines. Now, the creator of the visions is advising the visionary on how the vision ought to be treated. He said, write the vision. Write the vision and make it plain on tablets, so that he that readeth may run. So I hope you are writing this down. What comes first is not even the writing of the vision. What comes first is the reception of the vision. The vision has to be received first. You have to perceive the vision. And probably that is where most of you have a problem, in receiving the vision. You haven't yet received your vision. So if I talk about writing it down, you're saying you have skipped the most initial part, the starting point. How can I write that which I have not received? How can I receive a vision about my life? Which is a very, very complicated question. How can one receive a vision? Yet visions are given. And how can you make the giver of the visions to want to give you one? If you're finding it hard to receive a vision, why not do it this way? There is a way that you can receive a vision without having to wait for the vision to come. It's one thing to have a vision come your way. It's another thing for you to visit the vision. Okay? You can sit and wait for a vision to come, or you can leave your place and visit the vision. How? There is what I call envisioning the vision. When you envision something, you anticipate. It's a picture, it's an imagination of something that is yet to take place. And by envisioning a vision, you can have a mental picture of the vision, the nature of the vision that you would prefer. What sort of a vision would you want to receive if you are to receive one? Because that vision, you have it already, of a vision. The type, the kind of a vision, the size of the vision that you would love to receive. You see, I'm trying to simplify this. Instead of you waiting for the vision to arrive, picture the vision. What sort of a vision would you love, would you want to receive? And the moment you begin to envision the vision, suddenly you have tapped into the realm of visions. What sort of a vision that would make you happy if you are to receive that tomorrow morning? The moment you can think of such a vision, already you are lining up yourself to the right vision. You have to envision the vision. And then when you begin to envision the vision, what you begin to see is the actual vision. And when you receive that vision, you have to understand that your vision that you receive is never complete. It is inception. That's not how the giver of visions gives them to the visionaries. The vision, sometimes it comes to you half-baked. Sometimes the vision comes to you in skeleton form, bones without flesh. So the first stage is the reception. Before we get to the writing of the vision, the reception of the vision, where majority of our people have failed. They don't have the right frequency that can capture visions. So you receive the vision first, but it is not complete. There is a man in the Bible who was on his way to Damascus to destroy the Christians. And then, right in the afternoon, there was a vision. And the Lord appeared to him and he said, "I am Jesus, the one that you're persecuting." And he said to him, "Rise up, get into the city, and there you shall be told what you ought to do." So he saw a vision, but the vision wasn't complete. Then he was referred to a location where he would find the missing details, the missing parts of his vision. "Go there and you shall be told." So if you are going to wait until you receive a vision that is complete, that kind of a vision is never coming. Why it is never coming? Because it is not available. You receive it in fragments. You receive a vision in pieces. But as you begin to walk through that vision, you begin to pick the missing parts of that vision. Reception. The receiving of the vision. We have to start from there. You have to first and foremost receive the vision. Why? Unless the vision is received, you are not a visionary. You have to receive that which qualifies you to become a visionary. When you have been established as a visionary in your business, then that entitles you to superior ideas. Where everyone else at your workplace has run out of ideas, you always come up with the best ideas. Why? Because best ideas are always allocated to visionaries. Only visionaries have access to the best ideas. So qualify yourself by attaining a vision to become a visionary. Receiving the vision. You don't write the vision that you haven't received. If you haven't yet received a vision, envision the vision. Picture. Have a portrait. Have an image. Put that in a frame. Who do you want to become? Even if God was never going to give you the actual vision, are you still going to sit and die? For instance, this Monday morning, you woke up, you cleaned yourself up, you changed your clothes without a vision. You ate your breakfast, there was no vision. You never heard from God. He did not advise you to do that. But still, you had to find something to do. So when it comes to vision, let's say it doesn't come. Are you still going to sit and die? You have to envision the vision. Travel from where you are. Get to the place where visions are contained. And that place is within you. There is a place in your mind where your future is contained. You have to be willing to travel into yourself and discover that which God has deposited in your mind. What is it that you want to become? How do you see yourself in the future, 5 years from now? That's a vision. Now, once you have received a vision, you have to write it down. Write the vision. That's the second point. The first point, you receive it. Number two, it has to be written. And in writing your vision, there is a way that the vision ought to be written according to the biblical principle. Most people who do not follow the Bible, they follow this principle. What they don't love in the Bible is the God of the principles, but they love the principles of God. You can never run a business without fully applying the biblical principles. You have to have the vision, and then once you have the vision written. And there is a way that the vision ought to be written. God said, make it plain. You have to make the vision plain. Why he's advising you to make it plain? Because he knows most of you. You end up complicating the vision in an attempt to make your vision mysterious, in an attempt to magnify it and to make it bigger than it is already. You end up complicating the vision. And you don't simplify it, which is a problem. You might have already received the vision, but the way that you wrote the vision was not the prescribed way of writing down a vision. Make it plain. How do I make it plain? You might have seen yourself driving the most expensive car. That was a vision. But the how part, how you would come to that amount of money, was never part of that vision. You didn't see how the vision started. Where you were already sitting in the car, how you bought the car, that part was missing in the vision. So in every vision that you receive, there are missing parts. So number one, you receive the vision. Number two, you write the vision. How do you write the vision? You make it plain. Write it in a way that you can understand. Have you noticed that if you maintain the intensity of the dream in writing it down, 2 years down the line, when you try to read the dream that you once dreamt and you wrote it down, you're wondering, whose dream was this? Why? Because you didn't break the dream. You didn't break the vision down to your level of understanding. So I'm insisting that you do the best you can to simplify your complicated vision. Don't run with your vision at its level of complication. Simplify it. Make it easy. Make it straightforward. Come up with financial statements that you can understand. Introduce structures that are easy for you to deal with. As long as you can make the money that you always wanted to make, by making use of very simple strategies, still you have achieved your ultimate goal of making money. Don't complicate your vision. Some of the visions that we receive from God are made complicated by the visionaries. Some of you visionaries, you complicate very simple visions. You want it to make it big by complicating it. Make it plain. Let me give you an understanding, which probably most of you never heard about. You've never received that kind of understanding. You know, when you see a vision, whether the vision was in picture form or the vision was in an imaginative form, if the vision was an idea, and when you receive that vision, after receiving the vision, then you write it. When you begin to write, let me tell you something. When the moment you begin to write the vision, you immediately tap into the spirit of that vision. Immediately. Have you noticed that when you are a dreamer and you easily can forget your dreams and you say, I have to wake up and write down my dreams, you realize that every dream that you have written, you never forget it. You wake up, you write it, you go back to bed, you sleep, and you wake up the next morning, even before you can go back to the book, you can still remember. Why? It was as if you relived the dream. You have had an experience already. You have practiced the dream. So it gets established because already you have started participating in that vision. So you take full ownership of that which was once just a vision. Now you have already started acting upon the vision. So it is given to you permanently. It is printed in your mind. So each time you write a vision, you must understand, you are writing the vision on two places. Number one, on a piece of paper. Number two, in your mind, it gets written. So you're not writing the vision on a piece of paper. You are writing the vision in your mind by writing the vision on a piece of paper. That is why you can't forget the dream that you have written. The rest you forget. You see this? So, receive the vision. Write the vision. In writing the vision, make sure you simplify the vision. Make it plain. And then, the place upon which the vision is written is very important. God said, write it on the tablets. The tablets there are the stones. And stones are very significant. Isn't that the reason why God wrote his vision? On the two stones. The Ten Commandments. That was God's vision for us. Why writing the vision on a rock? The significance there is you have to attach your vision to an established place which cannot be erased. That's the way you can make your vision even eternal in some sense. Find something that can live. You know, there are archaeologists today who are reading scripts that are written on stones. What was written hundreds of years ago is still there on stones. So by writing your vision on tablets, you are making it permanent, so that even children or the children of your children, they will come and they will still be able to run with the Coca-Cola vision. Because it wasn't on a piece of paper. It was written on an established place. No matter how small that vision is, just make sure the place upon which the vision is written is big. You can make your vision big by the place upon which the vision is written. You can prolong the life of your vision depending on where you write the vision. It matters where you write it. If that didn't matter, then God wouldn't have advised his visionary to write it on the tablets. So make your vision permanent. Don't be changing every now and then. Be determined. Be focused. This is what I want to do. Today, tomorrow, day after tomorrow, we come your way after 1 year. You are still determined on the same vision. Why? It is encrypted on a rock. You are not always changing. That is the significance of the rock. It's an established place. Receive the vision. Write the vision. In writing the vision, you make it plain. And in writing the vision, write it in the right place. So there is a special place where visions ought to be written. Rock. When these things are in place, the vision has been received. The vision has been written. The vision has been simplified. The vision is on a rock. What happens is that infrastructure automatically will attract the reader of your vision. Helpers will gravitate towards such a monument. Immediately, you have the reader of the vision arriving. These are your employees. These are your workers. They will come. They have to read the vision, understand the vision, and proof that they've fully understood the vision is that you see your workers running. Hope you're following this. When your vision is still with you and you don't hand it over to the rock and you don't spell it out and no one reads it, then you are the only person who is trying to bring to pass that vision. But receive the vision, hand it over to the rock by writing it on the rock, simplifying it, so that your employees can come and fully understand the availability of the vision in the place, lest they perish, because they all come looking for it. And when they read the vision, they must understand it. When they've understood the vision, what happens first? That understanding of a vision will create momentum in your organization. People that came broke, people that came walking, they will leave running. So it is the clarity of the vision that creates the momentum at your workplace. The vision has to be clear. So I'm encouraging you right now to make sure that you tap into the realm of visions. Once you got it, by envisioning it, you write it down. In writing the vision down, you are tapping into the spirit of the vision. The vision that you had 5 hours ago, when you begin to write it down, the spirit of that vision will come to where you are. At the time of the writing of the vision, you will find yourself writing the missing parts of that vision. It becomes a continuation of that vision. Why? Because the God who would have given you the vision has seen you participating in the vision. Now he begins to provide the missing parts. So you will notice what you have seen and what you have written. They are two different things in terms of size. Why? Because as you were writing, you connected to the spirit of the vision. And the vision began to clarify itself because you were working in that vision and for that vision. So I hope I've made this clear. So get the vision, write the vision, make it plain, make it simple, easy for you to comprehend, easy for you to understand. Once the vision is clear, it is not just for you to understand. It is for the people that God has sent to help you to also understand it. And you notice in that scripture, it says, so that he that readeth may run. So it tells you that before they could read your vision, they were walking. But after reading the vision that has been made plain, people must be able to run. They acquire energy from a plain vision, a well-explained vision. God might have already given you a vision right now. What you just didn't do with the vision was to write it down and to make it plain. What is it that you want to accomplish in life? Are you there to solve every problem? Or there is a special problem, a specific problem that you'd want to solve? That is your vision. That is your dream. What are the answers? What are the questions that you would love to answer? That's your vision. What group of people do you want to help? Is there an individual out there who's believing God for your help? That's your vision. So I want you to understand this now. that a vision is a mental picture. Don't visit a place somewhere where you will think that you will find a vision there. But the place is inside of you. Get right into your mind and you will connect with divine deposits. Because whatever you will encounter in the future has already been experienced in your mind. The God that created you is a visionary. Before he spoke light into existence, he imagined it. So light was in an imagination form, vision form. Then he spoke what he had envisioned, and it came out of his thought. So before the light could shine in darkness, light had to first shine in his mind. Thank you so much. That's enough for today. See you next Monday.